And good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Yellow Jacket Coaches Show. I'm your host, Keith Womack, and of course, I'm here with head coach Steve Berdow. Tonight, we're going to talk about the Yellow Jackets game this past Friday night, a high-scoring loss to Scotland County, 56-43 final score. We're also going to talk about some of the top performers and get ready for the Yellow Jackets' final regular season game. And, coach, it's a big one versus the Southern Lee Cavaliers. And it'll be this Friday night at Paul B. Gay Stadium. Our coaches show this season is once again brought to you by an awesome group of sponsors and local businesses. And we'd like to take this time to thank them. And, of course, it's Wilkinson, Cadillac, Chevrolet, Buick, GMC, Domino's, Sheriff Brian Estes, Fix-It Plumbing, and Knott's Funeral Home. We're going to take a short break and hear from a few of our coaches show sponsors, and then we'll be right back with head coach Steve Berdow, and we'll talk more Yellow Jacket football right after these messages. And welcome back to the Yellow Jacket Coaches Show with head coach Steve Berdow. Of course, I'm Keith Womack, and we're ready to talk some Yellow Jacket football. Coach joining me here in the booth, as always, Yellow Jackets with a tough loss this past Friday night, going into a hostile stadium at Scotland County. Always been tough down there. But some missed opportunities by Lee County led to a Scotland lead, and then Lee County just couldn't overcome it. It's kind of back and forth the rest of the game, and it was a tough way to lose. Just to summarize it a little bit, Lee County led, of course, 21-14 midway through the second quarter, and then Scotland County scored 28 unanswered points at the end of the first half and the beginning of the second half. One of those, I believe, a pick six. Ended up taking a big lead. But Lee County had a couple of good performances offensively. We're going to discuss those shortly. We'll also talk about a few Yellow Jackets that are reaching and passing a few milestones here late in the season. Coach, your thoughts on the first half of the Yellow Jacket start in the first half of, the game last Friday night?
Yeah, I felt like the offense did pretty well. With an exception of a turn, we had one turnover in a key situation that we had an opportunity to really, we could go up two scores on them in that situation after we recovered an onside kick. And then right before halftime, we had an opportunity to be in field goal range, and we had an error that led to us not getting a field goal. So those last few minutes before halftime, offensively, we didn't get it done.
Well, Coach, let's talk about some of the stats offensively for Lee County, because Lee County offensively did not have an issue Friday night. Unfortunately, I wasn't there to watch. I was in Mexico for a couple of days, and glad to be back home. Glad to be back and watching Yellow Jacket football this Friday night. But Coach Drake Brown, 24 carries, 142 yards, awesome game. B.J. Baldwin, just 4 yards shy of 100. So altogether, 252 yards on the ground for the Yellow Jackets. I thought an excellent job there, and of course, a lot of that credit goes to the offensive line.
Yeah, O-line did well run game wise. You know, Drake continued to get those 4, 5, 6, 8 yard runs. B.J. busted one real long one. So those guys played well.
Well, Coach Jack Martin, 8 of 12, 147 yards. Aiden Poole, 10 of 13, 107. Altogether, Jackets 18 of 25 for 254 yards. Just a good, solid total.
Yeah, both quarterbacks very efficient. Had a couple turnovers that end up biting us in those situations. One of them you talked about went back for some points. If we can eliminate those type of things, then we could have scored 60 points in this game if we put everything together.
Yeah, I mean, the offense was moving along, and it seems like both offenses were in high octane last Friday night, according to John's recount of the game. A couple other outstanding performances we got to talk about. Jaden Hill just continues to amaze us all. Another 100-yard game, 9 catches, 113 yards. Raymond Knotts, I feel like almost having his breakout game here near the end of the season, because he had some injuries early. But seven catches, 103 yards. Jackets altogether, those 18 catches, 254 yards. Great job by the receivers.
Yeah, stat-wise, score-wise, points-wise, all those things, you know, we really liked offensively. You know, we when we went back and watched film, there were three or four series that we really felt like we could have done a little bit better. All right, and that's being picky, all right? But that's at the point in the season we got to be, especially in opportunities to win football games. We had two turnovers. We had the missed opportunity right before halftime that led to us not getting a field goal attempt. Then we had a three and out where we mis-executed a play by a couple guys that, you know, usually don't do that. That led to a three and out right after halftime. So those 4 minutes before halftime and a couple minutes after halftime kind of told that game.
And those missed assignments, Coach, I'm glad we weren't on the sideline for that exchange.
Yeah, we communicated and made sure they understood. And thankfully, the boys are intelligent kids, and they want to be coached, and they continue to push themselves. And most often, they know where they've messed up. It's just making that block or making that tackle.
Well, Coach, defensively for the Yellow Jackets, who have played pretty well most of the year, but Scotland's offense just too much. They struggled. Scotland able to move the ball up and down the field, scored a lot of points. Of course, a couple of those were off some of those miscues and turnovers. What made Scotland so hard to stop by last Friday night? Your thoughts on the defense and some of the players we'll talk about also that played well last week.
Yeah, I feel like they have two really, really good receivers that we knew about coming in. And the quarterback's a dynamic kid that can sling it and be effective enough in the run game. And their run game itself is one of the more complex run games to stop around. You know, it all comes down to being in the right spot, fitting, and tackling. And unfortunately, there's some situations where we had opportunities to make tackles, and instead of it being a 6 or 8 yard gain, you know, they broke it for a little bit longer than that.
Well, that's good running. I mean, that's what you teach them. Keep those legs turning, and certainly can't blame them for that. They ended up with 252 yards on the ground versus our 263. They ended up with 224 yards through the air versus our 254. So all in all, we kind of we outgained them, we out-defended them, but they outscored us.
Yep, and unfortunately, that's the one that they put in the book. So we got to continue to find ways to keep people out of the end zone and find ways to score more points than they do.
I tell at the end of the stats, at the end of the night, every time I read the stats, I always say, the only stat that matters is the final score, and sometimes some crazy things can happen. You know, we've seen a couple of games this year where we felt like the Yellow Jackets really outplayed their opponents, but didn't win because either, you know, it might have been a missed extra point or it might have been something that failed. Again, having a breakdown where somebody or maybe a couple of people miss an assignment, you end up with a pick six or you fumble. So there's a lot of things that can come into that, but Lee County obviously played well, and hopefully you want to use that momentum because of the good things you did do going into this week's game.
Yeah, definitely offensively taking that momentum and then defensively kind of taking it on the chin and, you know, getting back in there and making sure we're doing everything perfect and not letting anything slip through. Special teams-wise, I think we were very effective in our special teams. And I think they were effective in their kickoff game. They did a good job in kickoff, going down and covering, and that gave us some long fields. We were effective in getting those yards, but that was something that they did a good job of. So we got to continue to get better on our kickoff return unit.
Well, and stats can tell a lie once in a while. We have seen games where we way outperformed teams offensively, but when you go back and look at game film, we were starting drives inside the 20, and sometimes they're starting drives on the Yellow Jacket side of the field, so obviously that can be misleading. Coach, just real quick, when we come back from our break, you know, we're going to talk about some of the top performers and some of the awards we pass out, but what were some of the top performers, maybe even the top plays that you saw from last Friday night?
Yeah, I think early on we kick an onside kick. Great kick by Alex Burrell. We recover it, have a little momentum going right there. BJ had a really long run, 57-yard run down the down our sideline with a great block by the offensive line. Guard pulled up in the hole, and it was you know, if we were drawing it on paper, that was how we would have wanted it to all work out. And you know, BJ outrun everybody. We threw a little screen out to Jaden, and the running back and the receiver both made great blocks. So it's great to see people giving when they give great effort, how things work well. Ray caught a big post ball that was contested for a touchdown, and his seven catches for 107 yards was also his best game blocking. So all those things were why we were more effective offensively.
Well, you talk about some of the routes. You even talk about the long run by BJ. A lot of those don't happen, especially if they get to the outside or try to go to the boundary line. They're not going to happen without good blocking downfield.
Yeah, definitely so. Receivers gave great, much better effort in this game than I have seen, more effective blocking. And Cantrell and leading the offensive line up front.
And Coach, feel good about your special teams going in here to the final?
Yeah, I felt like Alex Burrell is continued to be dynamic in our kickoff game. Thankfully, we didn't punt much. They didn't punt much either, though. So those two teams didn't get much action. And on field goal, both teams were perfect, and we got a 2-point conversion on one of our 2-point plays.
So some good things happening all around. Again, just fell a little short on the scoreboard, and hopefully we can work to improve that this Friday night. As we said, Lee County will be hosting the Southern Lee Cavaliers, crosstown rival, at Paul Gay Stadium. Want to remind everybody, game time is 7:30. Come early, come tailgate, do all the fun things that you do with your family, but more importantly, come out and support all the football players here in Lee County, and we certainly hope to see you there Friday night.
Yes, sir.
All right, we're going to take a short break and hear from some more of our sponsors. We'll be back with head coach Steve Berdeaux right after these messages. And welcome back once again to the Yellow Jacket Coaches Show. Of course, I'm your host, Keith Womack, and I'm here with head coach Steve Berdeaux. Coach, had a chance to talk quite a bit about the loss to Scotland County last week. But we're going to finish Scotland County up with a couple of accolades for some of your players. And, of course, John and I typically each night have a chance to pick our Norman Financial Group players of the game, both on the offensive side and the defensive side of the ball, and also look at our Bubba Subs and Pizza Impact play of the game. And so we're going to talk about those a little bit. Coach, just want to get your comments on them. First of all, special thanks to the Norman Financial Group for this sponsorship. But our offensive player of the game, I thought by far his best game of the season. Our offensive player of the game, Raymond Knotts.
Yeah, I definitely agree. You know, started out with Ray making a couple big blocks that led to some runs. He catches a big post ball for a touchdown and had six more receptions. And we barely missed a throw to get him a second touchdown later in the game. So it could have been from a good game to a great game quickly for the way he played. So hopefully we can keep that rolling.
Well, congratulations to Raymond Knotts, our Norman Financial Group offensive player of the game. And, of course, we've got two sides of the ball, Coach. Got to look after the defensive guys, our Norman Financial Group defensive player of the game, Daniel Prince.
Yeah, Daniel, sophomore, getting after it on the defensive line. When we were putting game plan stuff in, we thought that him and guys that play his position would have an opportunity to be the defensive player of the game. So he made a couple plays in the backfield and made the plays that we thought he was going to. So good to see him getting that recognition.
And, Coach, you expect your upperclassmen to make big plays and to always kind of stand out. But when you have an underclassman like that come up, it's got to make you feel good.
Yeah, definitely so. You know, probably about 3 or 4 weeks ago, right before our bye week, it started becoming obvious. Like, he's a sophomore, but he's not playing like a sophomore no more. So that was good to see.
Well, congratulations to Daniel Pritz, our Norman Financial Group Defensive Player of the Game for last week. And, of course, we got the one that a lot of the kids love. It's the Bubba Subs and Pizza Impact Play of the Game. Comes along with a nice little sub for the young men. But our Bubba Subs and Pizza Impact Play of the Game coach, B.J. Baldwin, you talked about it earlier, a 53-yard touchdown run that put Lee County up 21-14 at the 9:36 mark of the second quarter, and that certainly had a huge impact at that moment in the game.
Yeah, definitely. So it was B.J.'s longest run of the year, blocked very well at all levels. You know, offensive line blocked well and the receivers blocked well, and B.J. took it to the house, and definitely at that point we had a lot of momentum.
Well, you know, we've talked about how well that the running back tandem has done this year. And especially, you know, looking over here at some of the stats, I wish I had the year-to-date stats, but how well Drake Brown's done. And I've told John several times, I said, but we can't count out the impact of B.J. Baldwin, because even though he doesn't have the yards, he doesn't get the carries that Drake does. He has been very steady for you guys this year.
Yep. As this season has went on, he's continued to grow up, I would say, as a varsity running back. Very good athlete, doing a lot of things on defense for us. He has right at 500 yards right now, and, you know, averaging over 7 yards a carry. And Drake's is just over 1,100 with about 7 yards a carry. So they're both very effective.
You think we can get him over 1,000 Friday night?
That's, that sounds good to me.
Well, of course, congratulations to B.J. Baldwin. Another award, a special award from Wilkinson Chevrolet Cadillac Buick GMC. And, of course, that's when you guys have a chance to go back and examine the game film, and which I know you guys do either late Friday night or first thing Saturday morning. You're already on it for next week. But looking at the game film, Coach, you chose a special player with a very special night last week. Congratulations to Raymond Knotts.
Yeah, we thought that this was Ray's best game so far, and we've seen him make some plays catching the ball. I feel like this was the closest thing to him playing a complete game of giving the effort we expect, blocking, to dominate some people at times blocking, and that was the difference, I felt like. And obviously the things he did in the running game also ended up turning to be pretty good for him in the receiving game too.
Well, congratulations to all those players for those awards, and you know, it's always nice giving those out. Hopefully the guys take them to heart, because they got them because they earned them and they deserve them. So congratulations to all the players who won something. But now, Coach, that was all last week. Mm-hmm. Scotland County unfortunately lost, but that game's over. Now it's time to focus on this week, and what better to focus on than our cousins, our friends, our neighbors in some cases, the Southern League Cavaliers. Cavaliers, a big victory over Union Pines 2 weeks ago. A little momentum going into this game. This is the Brick City Bowl. Possible third conference spot for the postseason goes to the winner. We know we'll probably get two spots. We're guaranteed one. There's a good chance we may get three, but this is a big game. Always has big implications. And, of course, Friday night at 7:30, Paul B. Gay Stadium will be no different.
Yeah, I expect there'll probably be a few people out there in Paul B. Gay Stadium for this one. You know, all the boys are excited. The JV kids are excited about going over on Thursday night to play. There's some people in town that's the only game they pay attention to all year. You know, and they're a good football team. Yeah, they have offensively. I would say they're similar to us with the situation. They're playing guys both ways. They have some very high quality athletes that don't leave the field. You know, quarterback wise is a dynamic guy that can throw it and can run it and has done that the last few years. I think they have a veteran group overall, especially at the skill spots. Both of coach's sons are outstanding players, so they definitely are a lot to prepare for.
And they had a lot of momentum coming off of last year's playoff, mm-hmm. Getting into the playoffs coming into this season. Some of the games didn't quite go the way they wanted them to, but that's the way football is. And, you know, it's going to be exciting to watch the game Friday night. But, Coach, what do you know about Southern Lee, and what concerns do you have in preparing for their offense, and then we'll, after you get through with that, we'll talk a little bit about basically the same question. What do you do, or what concerns do you have in preparing for Southern Lee's defense?
Yeah, offensively, they do a good job of mixing up run and pass. Have a couple guys that can carry the ball, including the quarterback, who's definitely an effective runner. They spread the ball around to a couple different receivers. And you know, the one thing that's noticeable is when those guys catch the ball, they have a goal of going to score. It's not they're not looking around to get tackled. When they catch it, they go try to find the end zone, and the receivers, they have some speed.
Yeah, certainly some talent there. And so when they're on the defensive side of the ball with Lee County, when we have the ball, what can we expect to see from them? What type of defense will they run against Lee County?
Yeah, I think I would consider it being, I would say they're aggressive on defense. Some of those same fast receivers are some of their guys playing linebacker and in the secondary, so they have some good speed on defense. They run to the football well, and I think they give great effort. That's something that's been noticeable throughout their games, where they've been able to cause a turnover here or there because they were running to the football, and usually good things happen when you run to the football.
Well, it's always a big battle. Like I said, you know, I always find it funny that some of the fans get a little into it a little too much. But at the same time, we know the players probably on Saturday or Sunday are hanging out at church or out on the basketball court or somewhere just having fun together, because these guys know each other. They played Little League football all their lives together.
Yep, you know, competed each other in middle school. Some of them went to middle schools together. Definitely playing youth football or playing AAU or, you know, rec basketball or whatever they might play in their free time. Probably playing video games together right now. But, you know, the boys are the boys. They're going to be buddies after the game. But on Friday night, they're going to be worried about beating each other. That's all they're going to be worried about.
Well, Coach, we certainly wish you the best of luck. And I'll just say, before we go to our next commercial break, too, we're very fortunate to have you and Coach Blanks, two class coaches here in Lee County. And we'd just like to thank you, for both of you guys, for, I guess, the way you support and represent the community.
Yes, sir. I appreciate it, and appreciate all you guys do to give us the opportunity to support these boys and recognize each week these kids.
Well, we'd like to thank you all for listening. We're going to take another short break, and we'll be right back after this break. Welcome back for the final time to the Yellow Jacket Coaches Show. I'm your host, Keith Womack, and a special thanks to head coach Steve Berdeau for coming in tonight. And of course, our Coaches Show each week are brought to you by some of the finest retailers and sponsors that we could ever ask for, and we certainly hope that you will thank some of these advertisers if you see them out in the marketplace in the next few days. And of course, bringing you the Coaches Show all year has been Wilkinson Cadillac Chevrolet Buick GMC, Domino's, Sheriff Brian Estes, and Fix-It Plumbing, along with Knott's Funeral Home. We'd like to thank you all for listening to tonight's show, and best of luck to the Yellow Jackets as they play at home this Friday night, where they will host the Southern Lee Cavaliers. We'll re-air this coach's show at 6:30 on Friday night, and we'll be on the air at 7, and get ready for a 7:30 kickoff. Come to the game if you can, and if you can't, join us this Friday on 105.5 WFJA. Let's go, Jackets.